ostende nobis Domine misericordiam.
Thank you.
gloria in excelsis et omnipotens et misericors Deus, universa nobis adversantia propitiatus exclude. Ut menete et corpore pariter expediti, quae tua sunt liberis mentibus exequamur. Per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum filium tuum, qui tecum vivit et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum. Oremus. Deus omnium fidelium pastor et regitor famulum tuum Franciscum, quem pastorem ecclesiae tuae prece voluisti propitius respice, da eique sumus verbo et exemplo quibus preest proficere, ut ad vitam unacum grege sibi credito perveniat sempiternam. Per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum filium tuum, qui tecum vivit et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Through me, the way into the suffering city. Through me, the way to the eternal pain. Through me, the way that runs among the lost. Justice urged on my high artificer. My maker was divine authority, the highest wisdom, and the primal love. Before me, nothing but eternal things were made, and I endure eternally. Abandon all hope, ye who enter here. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, amen. Dear canon, dear community members, these words from Dante's Inferno do not constitute an inspired source of divine revelation. They were nonetheless written by a faithful Catholic in an era when the Church was flourishing in all realms of society. And they capture fairly accurately a reality which comes to the forefront at the end of this Sunday's Gospel. It is a topic which is very unpleasant and which is very disagreeable for anyone obliged to preach about it, but which we ignore to our greatest peril. This is the existence of hell and the possibility that we all have of going there. Our Lord's parable of the king who prepared a wedding feast for his son ends on a somber note. The guest, who had no wedding garment, being speechless at the king's interrogation, is left to hear these wrathful words: "Bind his hands and feet and cast him into the exterior darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth." The reality and the eternity of hell are challenged from all corners of society today, both within and without the church. Many of you have probably heard others affirm their non-belief in hell. And these are similar words: "I don't believe in hell. After all, how could a loving God send a people to a place of eternal torment?" What they fail to understand is that hell is a necessary consequence of God's holiness and of his love. God's very nature, which is holiness itself, prevents him from countenancing even the slightest evil in his midst. The book of Revelation makes this clear: "There shall not enter into it anything defiled, or that worketh abomination, or maketh a lie, but they that are written in the book of life of the Lamb." God's infinite love for us compels him to respect our free will to the fullest, even to the point of our choosing to eternally separate ourselves from him. No one is compelled to go to hell against his will. Every single soul in hell made a deliberate choice against God at some point in their existence, and their will was fixed in this choice at the moment of death. If we would imagine the impossible, God opening up the gates of hell so as to show mercy and deliver the damned souls from their torments, the inhabitants there would slam the gates shut again in rage and indignation. Most of you are probably familiar with the principal teachings of the Catholic Church regarding the punishments of hell. You know that the souls there suffer more than anything else from their being eternally deprived of union with God. You know that hell is permeated everywhere by an unquenchable fire, which burns forever and which, unlike an earthly fire, never consumes what is thrown into it. In hell are found creatures which can only properly be described by the term monster, and which exist for one sole purpose: of inflicting eternal, unimaginable physical pain on the souls of the damned and on the fallen rebel angels who preceded them there with Lucifer. We should try to be realistic and considering our attitude toward the dogma of hell. Most of us have heard these descriptions of the punishments of the damned before, many times. Though we believe in them and they are true, they can, after a certain point, cease to seize us with the same fear and the same horror of hell that one would expect to find in a thoroughly Christian conscience. And in fact, the physical torments of hell, terrible beyond any conception, are still not the worst punishments to be found there. What tortures the souls of the damned, over and above the rest, is a movement in their soul, a double movement and a contradictory movement, which at once carries them irresistibly toward God in reason of his being their supreme good, and at the same time violently rips them away from him in reason of their obstinate malice and their hatred of him and of his holy will. In effect, these souls have freely chosen evil as their final and supreme good. They have obliged themselves to turn away from God, who is the unique source of beatitude, and who alone can satisfy their intense desire for supreme and eternal happiness. Their dying in mortal sins means the eternal loss of all good, supreme despair, and pain without the slightest shadow of hope or relief, pains elevated to a sovereign degree. And by the certitude of this word, forever, ringing incessantly in their ears, they will want for all eternity that which they will never be able to possess. They will wish to cease to exist, and yet always have to continue in existence, suffering intensely. In an abyss of absolute despair and absolute pain, they will know remorse, but it will proceed only from their hatred of God and their predicament, from the knowledge that the regret of their sinful conduct will remain forever too late. Thus our Lord addressed this admonition to the chief priests and the Pharisees, they who were precisely the ones who had the most need of such a warning, blinded as they were with the hatred for the Messiah in their midst. His words must therefore be understood as an act of great mercy, an attempt to divert these ill-willed men from the road to perdition that they had voluntarily put themselves on, so that they would not be lost forever. And so he continues to treat with us today. In the history of the existence of the universe, God has not created one single human being whom he wished to see perish into eternal damnation, and he never will. He always and without exception desires, as the psalmist puts it, that the sinner be converted and live. And he will never damn any soul to eternal punishment unless that soul, dying in deliberate mortal sin, voluntarily robs God of the ability to save it. Our God is slow to anger, full of love for his creatures, and much more inclined to mercy than justice. So during this month of the Holy Rosary of our Blessed Mother, let us recite our rosaries every day with an ever greater fervor, asking our Heavenly Mother to pray for us at the hour of our death, and asking Jesus to save us from the fires of hell, in imploring our mother's aid in this deadly struggle with the principalities and powers of darkness here below. Those who die in a state of separation from God have no hope. So let us from this very moment take refuge in the arms of she who is our life, our sweetness, and our hope. In doing so, we will surely not be lost forever. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Domnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu
tuo. Sum coda. Sagamus Domino Deo nostrum.
Dignum et justum est.
Vere dignum et justum est, tecum et salutare. Nos et ibi semper et ubique gratia sagere. Domine sancte pater omnipotens et terrene Deus, qui cum unigenito filio tuo et spirito sancto unus est Deus, unus est Dominus, non in uniu singularitate personem, sed in unius trinitate substantiae. Quod enim de tua gloria revelant te credimus, hoc de filio tuum, hoc de spiritu sanctum, sine differentia discretionis sentimus, ut in confessione vere sempiterne cui deitati, et in personis proprietas, et in essentia unitas, et in majestate adoretur equalitas. Quam laudant angeli adque arcangelim, cherubim quoque ac seraphim, qui non cessant clamare quotidie una voce dicente.
Thank you.
per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Oremus, preceptis salutaribus moniti, et divina in institutione formati, audemus dicere. Pater noster, qui es in celis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo erit in terra, panem nostrum quotidianum da nobis hodie, et dimitte nobis debita nostra, sicut et nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentationem. Per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Pax Domini sit semper vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Thank you.
Ecce alius Dei, ecce gutorget peccata mundi, Domine non subsidius, et fais peccum meum, set autum dicebo, sanctor anima mea. Domine non subsidius, et fais peccum meum, set autum dicebo, sanctor anima mea. Domine non subsidius, et fais peccum meum, set autum dicebo, sanctor anima mea.
Thank you.
Domine medicinalis operation, et a nostris perversitatibus clementere expediat, et tu vis semper faciat inerere manadatis, per Dominum nostrum, Iesum Christum, Filium tuum, qui te cum vivit et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Oremus, redemptionis nostre munere vegetati, quae sumus Domine ut hoc perpetue salutis auxitio, fides semper vera proficia, per Dominum nostrum, Iesum Christum, Filium tuum, qui tecum vivit et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Dominus vobis.
Vos omnipotens Deus,
Pater et Filius et Spiritus.